For the second part of my talk, I'd like to describe various mathematical devices that composers have used in their music, and in particular, what we might call the geometry of music. We're all familiar with rounds, such as Frère Jacques, Row, Row, Row the Boat, or as here, London's Burning, where each singer in turn takes up exactly the same theme over and over again. Such rounds exhibit what we mathematicians call translation, where we move something along. But more interesting are canons, in which certain phrases are translated to another voice or instrument at the same or a different pitch. One of the most famous of these is the 16th century Tallis's canon, which I'll play to you. Here the tune begins, and then the tenors sing exactly the same notes, but four beats later, as we can see in the music. I've marked the notes in red. But as Benjamin Britten showed in his opera Noise Flood, it also works as a canon in more parts, even going up to eight, as you can now hear. One of the most remarkable canons ever written dates from about 1300. Summa is a cumin in. Here the two lowest parts are in a two-part canon, while above are four singers doing their own canon. You'll hear the two-part canon first and then the other one comes in. One of the most beautiful canons I know is the Chaconne from Henry Purcell's Masque Dioclesian. Here the two recorder players are an exact canon throughout, the second just two bars after the first, while underlying this is a ground bass, a six-bar phrase repeated over and over again throughout the piece, which you'll hear first. Here's how the piece begins. Try to listen to both the ground bass and to the canon. Thank you. From earliest times, composers seem to have enjoyed setting themselves challenges, seeing where they could compose acceptable music subject to given mathematical restrictions. For example, here's an unusual Tudor canon. As you can see, three of the parts start in quick succession in close canon. Meanwhile, the other part, the third one, called a cantus firmus, sings a four-note phrase over and over again. But first with eight beats on each note, then seven, then six, five, and four, and eventually going right down to one, and finally to a half. Another challenge is to compose music in which the parts are in canon, but at different speeds. A short but effective example of this occurs in the fifth movement of Brahms's Requiem. Here the soloist at the top sings, "I will again behold you." And the tenors then respond immediately by singing the same tune, but at half speed, copied by the sopranos. And here's an example from the 15th century by Josquin des Prez. Here's the beginning of the bass line. This identical tune is meanwhile sung by the tenors, but at half speed as a cantus firmus, starting on a different note, and also by the sopranos in triple time. The final effect is complex and very striking. An even more complicated example was by the American composer Conran Nancarrow. In one of his canons, four voices play the same tune at speeds in the ratios 17 to 18 to 19 to 20, all entering at different times in such a way that most of the music seems completely chaotic. But at the climax of the work, they all come suddenly and miraculously into time with each other. Apparently, at one performance, there were complaints from the lecture room next door where they were trying to hold a seminar on coping with stress. Many mathematical devices used in music involve the geometrical idea of symmetry, an important area of mathematics that we study under the name of group theory. Here you can see the different types of symmetry that can occur for the letters of the alphabet. And I'll play musical illustrations of some of these in a moment. Our first type of symmetry is reflection or vertical symmetry, such as occurs with the letter A. Write it backwards and it remains the same. It's often called a palindrome, a sentence or a piece of music that's the same, whether played forwards or backwards. And one of my favorite examples is this delightful minuet by Joseph Haydn from his piano sonata number 41, where you can either start at the beginning or work backwards from the end. The composer liked it so much that he used it again in his 47th symphony, which you can hear online, and also in a violin sonata. Such palindromes often illustrate the subject matter of the piece. An early one was by Guillaume de Machaut in the 14th century when setting the words, "My end is my beginning." While a modern example is by the American composer George Crumb, whose madrigal, "Why was I surrounded by mirrors?" is full of patterns that run the same way backwards as forwards. Such reflections were also used by Alban Berg in his opera Wozzeck, where whole chunks are the same backwards as forwards. And there's even a whole opera by Paul Hindemith, Hin und Zurück, which you can listen to either way around. And here's a so-called crab canon from Bach's musical offering. If we read the first line backwards, we get the second line and vice versa. We can think of this piece as being written on the one-sided surface known as the Möbius strip. And indeed, we can see it performed in that way online. Let's listen to it and feel free to follow it from either the beginning or the end. My least favorite canon is also by Haydn, his canon Cancrisans, where each section is a three-part canon on the words, "Thy voice, O harmony, is divine." Here, each part in section two is the same as one of the parts in section one backwards. And the same thing happens also when the music is then turned upside down. With so many restrictions, the composer managed to produce a piece with no musical merit whatsoever. So we won't perform it. He wrote it on receiving his honorary degree from Oxford University in 1791. And let's hope that it wasn't performed until after he'd received his degree. This device of turning music upside down, or inversion, has been used more effectively by some composers, exhibiting the symmetry of the letters C, E, and K. The Hungarian composer Béla Bartók used it in his Microcosmos in a piece called Subject and Reflection. Here's how it begins. There's also an ingenious example from Bach's The Art of Fugue, where each of these two fugues is the inversion of the other. The first one begins as follows. And turning it upside down gives the second one. A well-known example is Rachmaninoff's Rhapsody on a theme by Paganini. The main theme is this. And if you now turn it upside down, slow it down, put it in the minor, and jiggle it a little, you get the other well-known theme. Of course, there's no reason why we shouldn't combine symmetries. And this was done by the English composer John Taverner in his carol, The Lamb. Here, the soprano line starts with a one-bar phrase. Which is then sung again while the altos sing it upside down. The sopranos then sing another phrase, first forward, and then backwards. This is then repeated with the altos singing it all upside down. And then there's normal four-part harmony. Let's listen to the beginning of this. A different type of symmetry is rotation, and here again there are musical examples. In Paul Hindemith's piano work Ludus Tonalis, which lasts about an hour, the whole of the last section is obtained by taking the first section and playing it upside down and backwards, that is, by rotating it through 180 degrees. So apart from the very last chord, rotating the whole first movement through 180 degrees gives us the last movement. Its symmetry is that of the letters N, S, and Z. These types of symmetry all combine in pieces of so-called 12-tone music, where we first list the 12 notes of an octave in any order we choose. And this is called a tone row. Here's an example. We've called it P0. But we can then play the tone row transposed up any number of semitones, here six, giving P6, or inverted, giving I0, or both, giving I6, for example. And any of these can also be played backwards, giving us a total of 48 variations of the original tone row. And here's an example from Schoenberg's piano suite, showing several forms of the same tone row. In each form, the 12 notes can appear in any octaves and with any time value. Recent composers have employed various mathematical ideas in their compositions. For example, Debussy and Bartok may have designed the proportions of the sum of their pieces in accordance with golden section, though there's quite a lot of dispute about this. While Alban Berg based the structure of his lyric suite on the two numbers 10 and 23. The American composer John Cage used ideas from probability, tossing a coin to determine the various musical parameters. While Yanis Xanakis, shown here, in his Metastasis, bases glissandi on the lines of a curved geometrical surface, actually the Philips Pavilion at the 1958 Brussels World Fair. Meanwhile, Sir Peter Maxwell Davis, formerly master of the Queen's music, was using magic squares in some of his compositions. A magic square is a square in which the numbers in each row and the numbers in each column all have the same sum. In one piece, A Mirror of Whitening Light, he started with the eight note piece of plain chant on the right and the 8x8 magic square on the left, in which each row and column adds up to the same sum, 260. Combining these in a particular way, he obtained his so-called magic square of Mercury, shown at the bottom, and then by tracing through its entries in various ways, he generated the note sequences that he then used in his composition. And here's another example of this. The Oxford composer Robert Sherlock Johnson used fractal ideas to weave sound patterns. Using this particular recurrence relation for different choices of the numbers A, B, and C, he obtained attractive patterns of points X, Y in the plane, such as the ones on the left, corresponding to the choices given, so-called fractal art. But next, taking each X value to represent the pitch of a note and each Y value for the loudness, he produced sound patterns, which he then used as the basis of his compositions. To end with, I'd like to show you how the American composer Carlton Gamer was so inspired by some geometrical ideas that he based a composition on them. In mathematics, there's an object known as the seven-point projective plane or Fano plane. Don't worry about what it is exactly. Just notice that it has seven points, which I've called A, E, H, R, T, W, and Y, and seven lines, each linking three points. I've had to bend one of the lines to fit it in, but don't worry about that. In fact, if you look at the three letters on each line, you can spell out the title of this talk. Yay, why, try, her, raw, wet, hat. What Carlton Gamer did in his composition Fanovar was to assign a musical instrument to each of the seven points, and then to use the lines to group the instruments into trios that play together at various points in the work. For example, as you'll see, the second variation starts with a trio of flute, violin, and clarinet, which appears on the right of the lower diagram. He then took another seven-point diagram from a mathematics book that I'd written and used paths in this diagram to generate the harmony and melody. For example, the notes C, D, and G appear in the triangle on the left, and the path A, B, F sharp, and E appears on the right. So here's part of the music. And you can see the trio of flute, clarinet, and violin appearing on the left. The C, D, and G together in the bass, and then up above, the tune based on A, B, F sharp, E. It's actually much more complicated than this, but I hope you get the general idea. I don't have a CD of Fanovar, so as promised, I thought we'd end with another of Carlton Gamer's compositions, his 31-tone piece Organum, with 31 notes in each octave. It's based on words by Ezra Pound, and both vocal and instrumental parts were electronically synthesized from the composer's voice. It's quite short, just a couple of minutes.
What thou lovest well remains, the rest is dross. What thou lovest well shall not be reft from thee. What thou lovest well is thy true heritage. Whose world, or mine, or theirs, or is it of none? First came the seen, then thus the palpable, and then seen. Though it were in the halls of hell. What thou lovest well is thy true heritage. What thou lovest well shall not be reft from thee.
And finally, if you'd like any further reading on music and maths, here are a couple of books. Thank you very much for listening.